when Monsignor Jose Mario invited us to go to his archdiocese. He left it very clear that he wanted us to dedicate ourselves especially to the task of evangelization. And since we've arrived, that's what we've been doing. And we were, the first month, observing everything. In the parish, they told us to look, observe, and within a month, we'd see the things in particular that we wanted to dedicate ourselves to, and in what things in particular we would like to work. And it's because there's so much work. There would be work enough for many more sisters. Every day you would like to take on much more than it's actually possible. And we have a great danger of falling into activism. And so we've realized that it's most important for a religious brother or sister in the missions, with so much work all around us on a spiritual level, human level, and social level, that we need prayer. We agree in two things, both the priest of the parish as well as ourselves who are there. We see two essential points in which we have to work: the catechism and the youth. In catechism classes, we have nearly 1,000 children preparing for their first communion and 400 people for confirmation. Our principal work is to coordinate, guide, and form the catechism teachers. It's amazing as well to be able to teach catechism to adults. It's been a new experience for us to have young people around 20 to 30 years of age preparing themselves for baptism, even elderly people of 80 years of age preparing for the First Communion. And it was especially gratifying for us, an experience that we had with a girl who now forms part of the youth group of the Home of the Mother. She approached the group meetings with a friend of hers from school, and little by little, we saw how she started to change and how she went soaking up everything that was said to her in the meetings. And in less than a month, she prepared for her first communion and her confirmation. And even now, she still says to us that when she goes to receive the Eucharist, it's like the first day that she received. She receives with the same fervor, the same love that she did on the day of her first communion.
And you can see how the small children open themselves to the Lord. We have had lovely experiences with children, like a little boy who was 4 years old when we met him. Every time he would see us in the church, he would sit beside us. And then he would continuously ask us questions during the Mass. And when he saw us going to receive communion, he asked why we were receiving this little piece of bread. And we explained to him that it's not bread, it's Jesus. Then he started saying to us that he wanted to receive Jesus. And every day when we arrived for Mass, at the moment of the consecration, he snuck up through the church and placed himself before the altar. And when the priest elevated the Lord, he started to wave at him and wave at him. And when we went to receive communion, he stood in front and did this. And we said to ourselves, what a beautiful spiritual communion made by a 4-year-old boy who is saying to the Lord, come. So great was his desire to receive the Lord that he convinced his parents to baptize him because he wasn't baptized. That child afterwards, seeing the other girls who came to the house every day to visit Jesus in the Eucharist, this was also a beautiful experience the Lord is permitting us, to see how the souls are getting to know the Lord in the Eucharist and drawing closer to him. Well, this child, seeing them, started to go many days also to visit Jesus in the Eucharist. And he brought older boys, older than himself, saying, come on, come on. And he showed them how they had to greet the Lord in the Eucharist.
Every Tuesday, another sister and myself, we go to a clinic to give it a name or call it something, because it's a tiny room with very little ventilation and very little light. So we go to this clinic where there's about 15 girls, that have behavior problems due to alcohol and due to drugs. There's also girls who have been involved in prostitution. And we give them catechism, and we speak to them as of other subjects as well. We give them a human and spiritual formation. We've also taught them how to pray the rosary. For me, to go to the clinic on Tuesday, it's as if the Virgin is urging me to be her instrument. I know that she wants to manifest herself through us, to act as a mother through us. There, the girls say that Tuesday is the best day of the week for them. And I don't think it's because they're fond of us and that's that, but because they feel our mother's presence through the little or much that we can do with them. In these girls, there's been a great change. The Lord transforms their hearts through the catechism, their thirst for God. They ask everything, and sister, why this, and sister, about the Holy Trinity, and about Jesus Christ and his life. And many of them change their lives and fix their situations. It's the Lord that's transforming them.
The children there have a thirst for God. While here in Europe, as soon as there is the slightest difficulty, such as rain, you know that on that day, there will be no children at the meeting. Or if it's cold, or if it's a sunny day, they go elsewhere. However, there's been days with tropical rainstorms, the torrential ones that they have there, and we said to ourselves, well, today nobody's going to come, and we nearly didn't bother to prepare the meeting. And all of a sudden, when it's time for the meeting, you open the door just in case, and there at the fence, you see a line of children getting soaked, waiting for you to talk to them about the Lord, and afterwards play a little with the sisters.
One of the things that impresses me the most in the missions, or the thing that impresses me the most, is to be able to bring communion to the houses of the sick. We've made a little bag of cloth where we keep the Lord. It's amazing because you can bring Jesus present in the Eucharist to people's homes. We place them on poor chairs, and it impresses me so much to see the humility of the Lord, how he lets himself be handled, how he stays where you place him. It impresses me a lot, the joy that the sick receive when Jesus visits their homes, and how the Lord, present in the Eucharist, transforms them and fills them with strength in their illness. He fills them with joy. And he will come, the one who invited you and the other, and he will say, give your place to this one. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Sometimes when I go to the radio with another sister, as we do a program for children, on the way there we would have had a good laugh. Because if they told me years ago that I would have to talk on the radio, I would have died of embarrassment. But where you, or at least where I find the strength and the joy to live everything and to do a task, whether it be more or less fulfilling, it doesn't matter to me. That's to say, I'm not doing this because it's something that I feel called to, or where I would fulfill myself, or because I like it, or I feel attracted to it, or because I have this character and I love it. But it's because it's what the Lord wants me to do, and I trust that the Lord, through poor instruments, will act. So when I look at the Lord sometimes and say, are you happy? Well, that's enough.
Because in these countries that are poor, that have a lack of hygiene, a lack of water, one could catch illnesses that could even kill them. And the missionary, when they go on the missions, they know this reality and they are prepared that the Lord might ask this of them. So when a missionary is sick, and we have had experience of this, you can see the generosity and the affection of the people towards the missionary, because they see the missionary as a messenger of the Lord, someone who comes to bring you a spiritual good. And I remember when some of us were sick, how the poor people that you know have no money to buy themselves fruit, or they don't have the money to buy themselves medicines, they arrive at the door saying, "Sister, here, I have a few cents. Take them so that you can buy a tablet to get rid of your headache." Or they come with a bag full of grapes that there in this city where we live, it's an expensive fruit, and they don't eat it as it's very dear, as it comes from the mountains, from Quito. Well, they bought this fruit that they know that we liked it. It's a good fruit. And they arrived with their grapes saying, "Here, this is for you so that you can get well soon and once again be amongst us, so that you can see the generosity of the poor."
It amazes me to see how God certainly works in the souls. And this impresses me more than hearing, "Oh, the missionary sisters, what heroes." And the Lord says, "There's more joy in giving than receiving." And it's true. You go there to give a little, because at the end of the day, leaving your house, your country, leaving certain things, the Lord gives you so much in exchange that you can't even measure it. The Lord grants you the grace to see up close and personally how He works in souls. And it helps me to see what our mother is like, the way she is, and how she acts. And this gives me a great peace, an amazing joy. And you can see this in the souls.
The joy that one experiences when one goes to bed exhausted for having given of oneself throughout the whole day to the Lord and to their brothers and sisters. We wouldn't have the strength if we didn't spend time in the chapel, if we didn't spend the day with our heart united to the Lord. It's very important for us to be able to have this life of union with God.
I wanted to tell you about some of the projects that we, thanks be to God, are carrying out, and thanks to the generosity of the people that from other countries help us. We are helping some children's soup kitchens. We didn't start this project ourselves, but it was initiated by an Irish missionary who has been 18 years working in Chone, in the city where we are working in Ecuador. But a moment arrived when the help didn't reach this missionary. And then she asked us for our help. Sister Margaret is her name. She came to us and said, "Look, they won't give me more money, and this month I will have to close 3 soup kitchens, and 500 children will be left to do without food." So we said, "We have to do something to help these children." And we started asking for help of Spain, and thanks to the donations that arrived, at present there are 4 soup kitchens up and running. And it's wonderful when you go to visit these soup kitchens. I remember one Christmas when we went to see them and to help the people who were there working, giving out the food. I remember feeling very moved by 2 things. One, that when you were giving out the plate with a little mountain of rice, which is what they usually eat, or a little pasta, on holidays maybe even a piece of chicken, but normally it's rice and pasta. And I remember one child that was sitting on the ground, as not everyone has a table to sit down and eat in these soup kitchens, or even a chair. Some sit on the floor. And a child of 2 or 2.5 years of age, when I went to give him a plate of pasta, without a word, because he could barely speak, he picked up a macaroni and showed it to me, as if to give it to me. And it moved me because you said to yourself, he's poor, and the little he has been given, he doesn't mind being left without it. He gives it to the missionary. And another thing that impressed me in a soup kitchen was a child that ate only half of his meal. And when I asked him, but are you not hungry? He said, yes, sister. Well, then why don't you finish your plate? Don't tell me you're going to leave that half on the plate. We're not going to throw it out. If you're hungry, eat it. And then the child said, this half I've kept for my granddad, who cannot come to the soup kitchen, and he's hungry too. Another project that we are carrying out is a project to acquire medicines, because their social security, to have social security is a luxury that few have. The majority of the people, when they go to the doctor, they have to pay. When you go to the hospital, if you need a band-aid, if you need a syringe or a bandage, you have to buy it at the pharmacy, and that means that you have to have money. The people don't always have money to buy these things, and there are people who even die because they cannot buy for themselves a bottle of blood or a bottle of oxygen, and it's a reality. While speaking to a girl, we asked her how many brothers and sisters she had, and she said, sister, we could have been three, but we're only two. And we said, why? What happened to your brother, the third child? He died when he was born. Why? Was he born with complications, with problems during the birth? No, sister. He was born with breathing problems. He needed oxygen. And my father ran to the pharmacy, but the pharmacies were on strike, and they wouldn't sell my father the oxygen. And my little brother died because he could not breathe. Seeing this need then, what we are trying to do is receive donations from people who want to help, who say, here, sister, this is for medicines for the people over there. And then when these people come to our house with the prescription, we go to the pharmacy with them and we buy them the medicine that they need, because it's a pity and it's an injustice to see and hear that there are people who die because they cannot buy these things for themselves. Another project that we started working on is a project on a school level to help the children, because there the culture level is very low. And not everyone has money to buy themselves a pencil or an eraser or a pencil sharpener. We in the richer countries are used to buying a new school bag every day or every year. Sorry, every day, no, but yes, every year. There they go with their little pencil and their eraser, if they have it, in a little plastic bag until the bag finally breaks. They told us of children who didn't have pencil sharpeners, and they sharpened their pencils with their teeth and erased with their saliva. So then we said, we have to do something. And we asked for help to be able to cover this school need, so that these children might have at least a pencil sharpener and an eraser and a copybook in which they can write. Because there are many children who have never gone to school, because many their parents are not interested, and others because it's the children that work in that house. We have seen children spend the whole morning stomping on mud, clay with water to make bricks. Children that head off to work with their bag of polish and spend the whole morning polishing shoes. And it's the only money that goes into their house. And these children, then, after having worked with bricks the whole morning or cleaning shoes, in the afternoon they have to go to school, but not driven many times by a desire to study, but because they are tired after having worked all day, but driven more by a desire to have a piece of bread and a cup of juice that they give them at the school. And that's the only thing they eat all day. But if we can acquire school materials and we can make school more attractive, we can help the people to have a higher level of culture, and the children can learn to read and write.